Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to panel three, which is entitled Global Counterterrorism and Regional Structures. We're lucky indeed to have four very eminent experts from different perspectives. And if I may, I'll introduce them collectively now, rather than before they each individually speak. Gary Ermutlu, immediately to my left, is the outstanding head of threat and risk at the United Nations Department of Safety and Security, and thus amongst us can claim to be a truly global practitioner. The UN provides a unique security perspective because of its out of city operations, refugee issues, delivery of food and health programs, make it a truly deep field security operation as well as a big city target. And Gary is to be congratulated because he's been instrumental in developing the analysis of the UN Department of Safety and Security to what I think is now a truly world-class operation. Mary Habeck is the adjunct professor at the Center for the Security Studies. She's previously worked for the American Enterprise Institute, the Foreign Policy Research Institute, and the John Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies, SIAS. She was appointed by President George W. Bush to the National Council of the Humanities, the Advisory Council of the National Endowment for the Humanities, where she worked from 2006 to 2013. Audrey Kurth Cronin is the author of the book Terrorism Ends, Understanding the Decline and Demise of Terrorist Campaigns. She's currently a professor at the School of International Service at American University. She was Distinguished Service Professor at George Mason University at Shah School of Policy and Government and the founding director of both the International Security Master's Program and the Center for Security Policy Studies at George Mason. She's an expert on political violence, terrorism, and conflict. The word expert is frequently deployed, but not always entirely true, but it is with Audrey. She is recognized by experts as the expert's expert. So we're delighted that you're here, Audrey. And an old friend, Fernando Reinares, is an adjunct professor and visiting researcher at the Center for Security Studies, as well as professor of political science and security studies at the University of Rey Jean Carlos, and director of the program of global terrorism at Elcano Royal Institute. Between 2004 and 2006, he served as a senior advisor on counterterrorism policy to Spain's Minister of the Interior and subsequently chairman of the European Commission Expert Group on Violent Radicalization. So we couldn't be better served with a panel. You're all enormously welcome. The format will be as yesterday. I'll invite each of the presenters wherever they're comfortable, either from the dais or from the panel table to speak for 20 minutes, and then we'll open it up for your discussion, comments, and questions. So should we start, Gary, with your good self?
All right. Well, thank you very much for the kind introduction, Sir David, and I'd like to extend my gratitude and appreciation to our hosts and event organizers, and a very warm welcome to the new administration. It's an honor to be part of this enterprise. For the record, the comments, observations, and views expressed by me this morning are my own and do not represent those of my present employer, the United Nations. In December 2015, Tony Cordesman from the Center for Strategic and International Studies coined a term, strategic tokenism. Dave Maxwell mentioned it yesterday. I'd like you all to consider it. We'll get back to it. Now, from this point forward, my comments and views will be expressed through the prism of living systems analysis. You ready? From a single cell to the nation states of the world, all living systems are open, self-organizing, complex structures that contain 20 critical subsystems that process inputs, throughputs, and outputs for information, matter, and energy to sustain life. How about that? In other words, the structural continuity of all living systems makes them predictable. Full stop. This enables intelligence analysts to understand complex systemic processes, model threats with precision, develop early, reliable, and scalable indicators, warn and predict with accuracy, 91 to 96% accuracy, I can attest to that, and evaluate for continuous learning. Because terrorist cells may be understood as living systems, that is, the work of human beings, the behavior of terrorists is fundamentally predictable. We know what they must be doing and what they must be doing next. And when you know, we also know that terrorists are most vulnerable during their preparation process. The challenge is to manage our information gathering resources to target the living system that sustains the terrorist as a system. Now, in considering the 20 critical subsystems in a living system required to sustain life, let's take a peek at one of the counterterrorism strategies that was debated yesterday, and that's targeting threat leadership. Whilst it is a suppressive strategy, it fails to starve the system. With the death of Abdelaziz al-Mukarrin in 2004, he was the emir for AQAP, Al-Qaeda adopted a principle borrowed from the German General Staff system, placing a field marshal's baton in every corporal's rucksack, whereas they groom select personnel two levels above and one level below their station. So when they lose a leader or a key person, they're usually able to replace them within 30 or 60 days. My opinion, we need to exert as much diligence and rigor in dismantling the critical subsystems, that is, targeting their auxiliary support networks. These include, but are not limited to, propaganda and recruiting infrastructures, information technology infrastructures, financial mechanisms, training mechanisms, and logistical infrastructures. As a sidebar, when ISAF began targeting Taliban villages where the IED makers resided in those particular areas, they began to get the IED situation under control. I've got a number of other examples we can talk about later, perhaps. Something I want you to keep in mind, what von Clausewitz wrote, everything in war is simple. The simplest thing is difficult. Keep that in mind as I go through the rest of my remarks. Now, there are some key challenges in targeting auxiliary support networks. I'm going to highlight two, one from two different levels, the operational level and one from the strategic level. Just one. At the operational level, one of the challenges is the emergence of the friends and family plan at the grassroots level, where a radicalized individual recruits friends and or family, or friends and or family radicalized together. This was highlighted yesterday. One of the key challenges is that they are difficult to detect, these particular cells, because their movement and communication are natural. They are, after all, friends and family. Woven into this is the fact that Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State ideological competition is becoming less relevant for these particular constituents. And this surfaced after the Paris attack in January 2015. What I am concerned about is that now that Al-Qaeda is poised to exploit a weakening Islamic State, we may see at the grassroots level an expansion to Al-Qaeda's strategic target sets, which are far more systemic than those of the Islamic State. One of the policy challenges is implementing Chapter 3 of Sun Tzu's Art of War. Some refer to it as the strategy of the sheathed sword, vis-a-vis hosts and safe havens for terrorist groups and networks. I'm going to highlight three challenges. There's a lot read into these. Understanding a group's relevance to the host, determining how to make them irrelevant to the host, and determining how to turn them into liabilities for the host. That's something you can chew on. I'd like to touch base on the phenomenology of the once and future threat. We need to maintain a holistic view of the threat at the strategic planning level. For decades, these groups have shared best practices, tactics, techniques, procedures, and technology transfers. So don't view these groups or their regional franchises in isolation. The world is their battle space. For example, and with regard to geographic and political space, if you take a map of Iraq from 2008 that delineates the areas of operation and influence of the Islamic State of Iraq, and you compare it to a map today, 27 January, you'll see that the areas of operation and influence of the Islamic State, same outfit, are eerily similar. Let me walk that back. In 2008, Abu Omar al-Baghdadi urged the redeployment of foreign terrorist fighters because he was losing geographic space. Where did they go? Other fronts of jihad. Algeria, where they helped reinforce AQIM. They established training camps that were very similar to those in Afghanistan. And those of you who have an interest in the Sahel, those that formed Ansar al-Din got some of their initial tuition there. They went to Yemen to help reconstitute AQAP. They went to Somalia. They helped improve their IT as well as do some training, and they went to Afghanistan. Today, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi is urging the redeployment of foreign terrorist fighters, of which he has many more. Now where are they going? Europe, West Africa, Libya. Same thing's happening in Libya, and like water through a channel, they're going to the Sahel to seek infiltration elsewhere in North Africa and sub-Saharan West Africa, and a broader expanse in Southeast Asia and the Pacific. With regard to political space, I have a lesson learned and a cautionary tale. Between 2008 and 2013, the political dynamics in Iraq and the geopolitical dynamics in the region gave the Islamic State of Iraq just that sliver of political space that allowed them to maintain their auxiliary support network and the system lived. My cautionary tale is to look now at what's happening and to the future. I'd like to touch a little bit on applying economy of force to global counterterrorism efforts, where we place our assets and our energy. My personal opinion is we need to reevaluate our investment in counter-messaging. I'm not saying don't do it, we need to reevaluate it. Presently, the circumstances are, I think it's a distraction in trying to rationalize the irrational because we're involved in mirroring a lot. Some of the examples I've seen of counter-messaging, we're approaching the message and the counter-message through a modern Western mindset. It won't work. Part, to be clear, of the message from the Islamic State group is from the cult of emotion. Who are they trying to recruit? Part of those who are there recruiting for foot soldiers have a mindset and a predilection for those of being serial killers, rapists, and sadists, and they like what they do. They exploit popular sentiments, such as tearing down the Sykes-Picot border, and they appeal to groupie behavior. A question was asked about the jihadist bride phenomenon. It's nothing new. It's the same behavior pattern as groupies to serial killers sitting on death row, and to a lesser extent, groupies to rock bands. Part of the Al-Qaeda message is through the occult of philosophical ideology. They have an empowerment message. They appeal to the aspirational desires of their constituents and those who embrace the safe sec philosophy. Where I do think we need to invest more time in, it's not a financial investment, it's more of a cognitive human resources development investment, and that is red cell exercises. It's an excellent planning tool at the operational level and some at the strategic level. But some of the problems that I've seen, again, is mirroring, approaching threat role-playing and analysis through a modern Western mindset. The way forward is fairly simple, but remember what Clausewitz said. So first step, we need to develop threat profiles and modelings that are partially forensic and partially through the eyes of the threat so we can better understand them more intimately. And here's the trick, nearly to the point of empathy, and that's where the mental discipline comes in. From there, we can identify their normality baseline, another living systems byline, and that is the normality baseline is how they manage and balance their own 20 critical subsystems. Then we can look at their doctrine. it's all printed out there for you to read. Islamic State, which also borrows from Al-Qaeda, the military doctrine, Nizam la Tanzim, system, not organization. They borrow heavily from and they cite Bill Lentz's 1989 article from the Marine Corps Gazette on fourth generation warfare. The People's Liberation Army treatise from 1998, Unrestricted Warfare. I give both these periodicals out in a workshop I give. And Sun Tzu's Art of War and von Clausewitz's On War. Then we need to determine with whom they are willing to ally and use as proxies. So I've just added a little bit of spice to the dish. Allies, proxies, threat more complex. Keep that in mind. I also think we need to invest more in indicator-based strategic warning. I'm not saying we're not doing it. I think we need to do more of it. Again, it's an investment in human resources and cognitive training. Our analysts need to improve their ability to consider the first, second, and third order consequences, that is thinking three steps ahead like a chess player, with regard to conditions impacting the threat and threat's response and intent. I'll give you an example. Perhaps in more detail in Q&A, but broad brush, Libya 2011 to Mali 2012 to Nigeria 2013. Another way to put it, Tuaregs to weapons to Ansar al-Din to AQIM to Boko Haram. And in the mix, we always need to consider potential consequences on counterterrorism policy plans and operations. I was also asked to identify some emerging trends from where I sit. I'm going to read off four. They're already in play. I just see them expanding and getting worse, and I have no positive thing to say here. So buckle up. One, marriages of convenience of terrorist groups with non-state actors, criminal gangs, cartels, and political factions. Two, emulation by non-state actors, criminal gangs, cartels, and political factions of terrorist groups' best past practices and successes. And if you haven't already done so, I would highly recommend you go out or get on Amazon and purchase Thinking in Time by Neustadt and May. Thinking in Time is an excellent policy manual, but above and beyond, it is an actual analytical methodology. Three, the emerging empowerment of non-state actors and vigilante groups on the world security environment. And there's a lot packed into my last statement at the geopolitical level, the use of scarce natural resources as weapons by non-state armed groups. In conclusion, I hope I'm doing well with time. Okay, in conclusion, at the strategic planning level, 4 points. One, we are moving to a perpetual cycle of threat management and crisis management. Keep those terms in mind. Two, therefore, more careful attention should be paid to strategic intelligence and strategic planning for more realistic risk management contingencies in anticipation of multiple crisis management scenarios across multiple regions and our respective homelands. Three, terrorism will be, as we say in the American South, the huckleberry to global threats. That is, influencing and impacting armed conflict, war, political violence, violent internal instability, which is one of the most difficult. Three, the militarization of criminal groups, cartels, and violent non-state actors. And four, we need to be honest with ourselves and know when to admit when we need help with skill sets, such as strategic intelligence warning and strategic planning. Now, in regard to that last statement, we're going to have an interactive pantomime. I'm going to ask you 4 questions. You don't need to say anything. Just raise your hands and be honest. Who has heard of the game chess? Chess, C-H-E-S-S. Now, when I say chess, think counterterrorism. Who can name 3 chess pieces? Okay. The questions are going to get more difficult. Who understands the premise and objective of a chess match? Okay. Last question. And this is easy because you're not invested in the game of chess. Who here has the skill set to play a chess master and think 6 to 8 moves ahead. Okay. See if we all be this honest in the counterterrorism community. My point is, if you're not strategically proficient, don't try to fake it. Know your limitations and be willing to ask for assistance, and then work towards eliminating strategic tokenism in global counterterrorism, which brings us right back to the beginning of my remarks, and that is Tony Cordesman's article he published on 3 December 2015. It was titled, again, Dave, this was no collusion between and Dave Maxwell and I, but the title is More Special Forces for Iraq and Syria, Tactical Asset or Strategic Tokenism. This article actually framed my mindset when I put these remarks together. I took two quotes from that article, and I want you to really seriously consider them. First quote, bright, shiny toys provide the best description for what has been influencing senior leadership's initiatives and decision-making processes. Second quote, strategy does not consist of stating intentions or broad concepts. It consists of realistic plans, justified actions, and necessary resources. Just wanted you to consider those, and thank you very much. This concludes my remarks.
Thank you very much. Can we show our appreciation to Gary? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Gary. As ever, that was concise, rigorous, insightful, and stimulating. Much there for thought. Mary.
Thank you. Thanks. my remarks are titled Covert Jihad, How Al-Qaeda and ISIS Take Advantage of Our CT Seams. And what I hope to do is lay out what I see as 7 of the seams in our current counterterrorism policy, and then offer a look kind of behind the screen at how Al-Qaeda and ISIS see these themselves and how they're taking advantage of them. Because one of the things we should not have in mind is that our weaknesses and our problems are somehow hidden from Al-Qaeda or ISIS. And they're not paying attention to them and looking for ways to take advantage of them. So I think these 7 in particular are things that they well understand and that they're using in order to spread not just their ideology, but to spread physically. So what are our seams? First and foremost are a set that I guess my social science colleagues would describe as endogenous or exogenous. Sorry, that's external to us. Things over which the United States has absolutely no control, but which we just have to take into consideration and seek to mitigate in whatever we do. And then I have a set that are pretty much endogenous. They're problems that we ourselves have and over which we do have some control, but we've been struggling with them for, 1988. I can't do math, so since 1988, and haven't seemed to find a solution to them. So they're really deep and serious problems, but they're things at least we know we have an issue with, and we simply have to attack more seriously over the course of the next few years. And that's the end of any social science in this discussion. I'm a military historian myself, so the language is not natural to me. The first of the seams, though, is, again, one of those things over which we really don't have much control, and it's something that was mentioned yesterday, and that is countries that simply lack the capacity to deal with their own problems. One of the things that one has heard repeatedly from a lot of Americans is, why does the United States have to be involved in all these places? Can't these countries deal with their own issues rather than engaging us? The truth is that there are very many countries in the world, for a variety of really deep and serious societal factors, cannot deal with their own problems. These range from things like not having the training in their military or in their security forces to deal with the size of the problem that they're dealing with, not having the money to be able to control their own borders, not having a great deal of internal corruption that prevents you from dealing with the problems with your borders or with a lack of capacity in your military or elsewhere. So there's a wide variety of different sorts of things that lead to a lack of capacity. But as was noted yesterday, the United States has spent a lot of time seeking to deal with this and has had very little success, especially with those who have the least capacity or the most difficult and ingrained problems with corruption in their own countries. We've had hardly any progress in getting them to be more capable in dealing with their own security issues. The second problem is sort of the other side of the coin here. These are countries that have capacity, but they're simply unwilling to cooperate, either with the international community, with the United States, with even a group of local sort of actors for, again, a wide variety of reasons. Either they see, in particular, Al-Qaeda as a moderate group with whom they can do business, the Taliban as a moderate group or actually a necessary group for their own national security issues, or they understand the problem as being something different than the United States or the international community understands it as. They think it's that ethnic group, that tribe, those people who have always been a problem to us, and we'll just treat them the way we always have in the past, and we don't need to have you outsiders coming in here and trying to tell us how to handle our own issues. And then there are a set of rather bad actors who have their own agendas for the greater Middle East and don't see those as lining up with either the international community or the United States, and they're off doing what they want to without cooperating with other people. And you can all have in mind a whole set of people that I'm talking about here. The third problem is what I call the Bonnie and Clyde problem, and that is the issue of borders. Because of international law, because of the United States' commitment to international law, because of our commitment to strengthening recognized governments rather than seeking to undermine them, for a whole variety of reasons, we have authorities that work on one side of a border but don't work on another side of a border. And what happens is you have hot chases that have to stop at the state line because you can't go across it. So just as Bonnie and Clyde could carry out their bank robberies right on the border and then zip across, you know, from Kansas to Missouri and count on the fact that there'd be no cooperation across that border, we have a lot of bad actors who understand this, who know our boxes, and are willing to use those and exploit those in order to carry out a lot of very bad actions across the Middle East. So the problem of borders is a really difficult one. It puts before the United States and others some difficult choices. Do you want to violate that border and violate international law in pursuit of U.S. national security interests? Do you want to empower a set of partners on the other side of that border, and by empowering them, enable them to achieve their national security interests rather than ours? Because one of the things we've learned over the past few years is when you empower others and do not put your own sort of skin in the game, what you're actually doing is empowering them to achieve their national security interests and not our own. And why not? On what basis should we expect them to die for our purposes and our interests? So if we choose to do that in order to get around the little border issue, we just have to keep that in mind. But those three, you know, just seem like, okay, those are outside there, you know, you struggle with them, there's the authorities issues, there's legal issues, there's all sorts of things like that. We've been struggling with them since 1988 and have made some progress in certain areas and absolutely none in others. But there's a whole set of issues that are not kind of beyond our control that we have to, you know, sort of struggle with externally. And these are issues that really have to do with our own problems and our own issues. So we shouldn't make it sound like it's all them, they have the problems, and it's not about us on this side over here. The U.S. also has a set of issues that we've been struggling with, and we've come to various answers throughout the intervening decades, and we've sort of gone back and forth on some of them. We've tried one thing, then we've tried another, and in none of the cases have we come up with a satisfactory answer to them that has allowed us to really take on and deal with this problem. So first of all, what is the relationship between Al-Qaeda and all of its affiliates. This seems like an easy answer, right? But in fact, we've had arguments about this right from the very start, the first appearance of the affiliates, and we are still arguing about this. And it's undermining all of our CT, or counterinsurgency, efforts. So let's give just some of the answers that are out there and how it's been applied over the course at least of the last 16 years. So the Bush administration decided that all jihadists were equally a threat to the United States. After all, we had not given al-Qaeda the sort of attention that it really needed for the threat that it presented, and they were not going to be surprised again. So they said, how do we know that these other jihadist groups are not suddenly going to take it into their heads to attack the United States? And so they sort of were lumpers. They put everybody into the same category of an equal threat to the United States. They put pressure equally on other governments to round people up and to do something about them. That this was never sat well with those who at least believed that they were the experts on this issue, even though some of them were in fact responsible for not paying enough attention to al-Qaeda during the 1990s. But there was criticism nearly from the beginning about doing this. All these groups were not equally a threat to the U.S. Many of them were local groups with local sorts of concerns, and they were never going to carry out an attack in the United States. Or they were mostly just criminals, you know, smugglers and so on and so forth, drug, you know, dealers and things like that. And why we should give them the level of attention that we're giving to al-Qaeda never really sat well with some people. So the argument was, nearly immediately after that, was we need to split these up into groups that are a local concern and those that are a global concern. So you have local jihadists and you have global jihadists. And global jihadists, not to put too fine a point on it, are those who want to attack the United States. Not that they want to attack everybody, but just that they want to attack the United States. I always thought that that was an amazing conceit on the part of very many people, that that's how you should describe people who want to attack the United States. So, but then how do you deal with all of these affiliates as they appeared? Well, in 2011, the Obama administration sort of codified one way of understanding this relationship. They said there's actually three different groups out there. There's al-Qaeda, they meant by that the core, the leadership. Then there are these affiliates, and you have the adherents. Al-Qaeda itself is a terrorist group that has to be dealt with through CT, and that is really the concern of the United States, their main objective, attacking the U.S. and so on and so forth. On the other hand, the affiliates are mostly local groups with local agendas, and they can sort of be put under the care of our partners, friends, allies, make it their concern, and we'll empower them and lead from behind, and they'll be the face and the people who are actually dealing with this issue. We'll simply give them the funding and support them in dealing with these affiliates. And of course, if the adherents are what everybody else calls lone jihadis, right? They don't have any organizational ties. They're really a law enforcement problem and can be dealt with solely through that. So this was an extremely convenient definition because it meant you didn't have to involve the military in the problem. It meant, in fact, that you could make it entirely a CT problem for the United States, and it was only a military problem for our partners out there. The problem is the abject failure of this concept from 2011 through to today. If you look at the growth of the problem throughout the greater Middle East, we've gone from four countries with an insurgency to 13. That involves al-Qaeda and ISIS. And we've gone from about six countries that have a serious terrorism problem to about a dozen. So we've more than doubled the problem, or the problem has more than doubled during this time, despite the fact that we have this new, shiny new definition of the problem that was supposed to make it more manageable and easier for the U.S. to deal with. So what is actually that relationship between them? Is it that you have to lump them all into one sort of problem, or do you have to splinter them or disaggregate them, as people like to say, in order to adequately deal with it? Well, neither one of them seems to have gotten us very far forward. The fifth problem is, I'm going to put it as names, but really it's about who is the enemy. So I already mentioned that the 2011 national strategy says that the problem is al-Qaeda. But if you go and look for the definition of what constitutes al-Qaeda in that particular document, you won't find it. It in fact defines Al-Qaeda in terms of itself. Al-Qaeda is Al-Qaeda. So what is meant by Al-Qaeda in this particular instance, and what has been meant by the Obama administration right up until January 20th when they talked about Al-Qaeda? Well, if you read Jay Johnson, if you read John Brennan, if you read others who commented on this, you come to the conclusion that what they meant by Al-Qaeda was, in fact, those people who carried out 9/11 and other people who want to attack the United States. That's it. Other people are not really Al-Qaeda. This is how you can say things like, it wasn't Al-Qaeda that attacked the United States embassy in Benghazi. This is how you can say Al-Qaeda was not behind other attacks around the world, because that didn't involve people who want to attack the United States or who carried out 9/11. This is because of a narrow construal of the AUMF from September of 2001, legal sorts of actions since then, and all sorts of other things that led to this sort of definition. Well, this is, again, a very convenient definition because it narrows the problem down. It allows you to say, this is Al-Qaeda and that is not. This is a real threat and that is not, right? But in fact, what it has led to is a spread of the threat around the world. It has not, in fact, led to a narrowing of this problem. And in addition, whenever these groups change names, they suddenly become not Al-Qaeda. So if you suddenly, you know, change your name to Ansar al-Sharia, you're no longer Al-Qaeda. You're not a problem any longer. If you change your name to Jaish al-Fat, you're no longer Al-Qaeda, right? So names have become a tremendously important tool for Al-Qaeda in order to mess with us and our boxes that we think we can put this problem into. The sixth theme is strategies. Does Al-Qaeda and ISIS actually have a strategy? For a very long time, there were arguments made that, in fact, they don't, that they just want chaos, that the only thing they want to do is attack the United States. John Brennan, in fact, in June of 2011, gave a talk over at SAIS in which he said, I'm not even going to address this fantasy that they talk about of creating some sort of global caliphate. It's beneath my, you know, beneath me to even dignify this with some sort of discussion. So if the United States, you know, looked at this problem, what they were seeing was, in fact, attacking the United States as the main sort of objective of Al-Qaeda. Everything else was sort of peripheral to this or some kind of fantasy. And otherwise, they really didn't have a strategy except, you know, terrorism and carrying out attacks and causing death and destruction and chaos. I had lots of conversations with other folks in which this was put forward as what they were really up to rather than having some sort of strategy. The result of this is that we have always been reactive. We're always reacting. We've never been able to be proactive because we don't think that there's a way to be proactive. We think we have to simply react to whatever they do. Okay, and finally, and this is something I believe Audrey's going to deal with a little bit deeper, and maybe we'll agree, I'm not certain, or maybe we'll disagree on this point, but is this actually a terrorism problem? As a military historian, we use the terms terrorism and counter and insurgency in very, very different ways. And it's not just a matter of terminology or wording or something like this. They require very different policies in order to be adequately dealt with. Terrorism can be dealt with by killing and capturing people. It works all the time. I think your articles, or your book was very good on this point, that you can win by simply killing and capturing. And it happened throughout the 70s, 80s, happened with ETA, it happened with a whole lot of different groups. Negotiation can also play a role here. But basically it's a law enforcement, maybe a little, as I like to tell my students, up armored, you know, like drones or something like that. But basically you can deal with it through attrition. You simply kill or capture them and the problem goes away. But insurgency is a very, very different animal. You cannot kill your way out of that problem. They're able to replace themselves faster than you can kill them off. And by the way, by simply killing people, you actually encourage others to join up. It doesn't deal with the problem of control of territory, of imposing the form of governance on you. The fact that they use guerrilla warfare rather than just terrorism in order to fight you and so on and so forth. There's a whole set of things that, in fact, drones will not deal with if you're dealing with an insurgency rather than a terrorism problem. So my point about this is we have to decide, are we dealing with a terrorism problem or an insurgency problem before we can, in fact, design any kind of adequate strategy for dealing with this. And I believe this is one of our internal seams that we have never really dealt with. Okay, so now I have 6 minutes to lay out how Al-Qaeda and ISIS are taking advantage of these. So I'm going to talk even faster. Now, since I have, there are 12 kids in my family, I'm used to this, but please forgive me if I, you know, get going a little too fast here. So what are their strategies to deal with? So how are they dealing, first of all, with the fact that there are a set of incapable countries out there? Well, according to Abu Bakr Neji, who's one of their main strategists, they understand that there are these priority states, places that they prioritized right from the very beginning that had ungoverned spaces that they intended to take advantage of. Well, gosh, wouldn't that have been nice for us to be thinking about in 2002, 2003 when this was written? Right? That they actually understood that there was this problem, they intended to take advantage of it. And they have been taking advantage of it. So the entire book is, in fact, how to take advantage of ungoverned spaces and what to do in order to create a state. Set up institutions, create a regular army, courts, all sorts of other things. That's what that book is really about. And it's widely spread around amongst Al-Qaeda groups and, in fact, is one of their main kind of training manuals. Secondly, unwilling countries. Well, actually, Al-Qaeda has a concept of neutralizing countries. In a book by Hazem El-Madeni called How We See Jihad and How We Want It, he argues that we can't fight the entire world, although that's what he says we ultimately want to do. Instead, we have to divide people up into the main enemies, that is, the United States, its allies, everybody they consider to be the Jewish crusaders, and I haven't misspoken, they really do say Jewish crusaders, because in their vision of things, the Jews are actually in charge and the crusaders are just their puppets. So in their vision of things, that's the priority enemy, right? That is the international system as well. They're equivalent concepts in their minds. And then there are a set of secondary enemies, all of those so-called apostate rulers that they'll take on secondly. And then there are a set of countries that maybe you can make deals with. And he talks about negotiations, about making sure you can put as many countries as possible into the neutral category while we focus on the Jewish crusaders and their allies. That's the important thing, to neutralize, carry out negotiations, do something so that others will not, you won't engage the entire world simultaneously. And from released Abbottabad documents, we know that they have been carrying on negotiations with various countries around the world in order to neutralize them. How successful they've been is another question, but they in fact pursued this policy. It wasn't just some sort of airy-fairy thing out there. So for unwilling countries, I think a strong look at whether they have in fact been neutralized might be something we might want to consider, that they're not just unwilling because they don't support what's going on, but because there's been some form of negotiation behind the scenes and they've bought into it. Thirdly, the statements, the borders issue, they understand very, very well. They talk about borders all the time, the fact that they don't support them, that they think borders are evil and wrong. They believe that their eventual caliphate, both groups, are going to spread to include the entire world. From observation and experience, we can say that they are taking advantage of this scene. Places like Syria and Iraq, Pakistan and Afghanistan, Nigeria, Mali, Myanmar, a lot of different countries, they are taking advantage of those borders in order to have training camps on one side and action on the other side. So this is another one of those things that if we really want to get at them, we're going to have to confront and deal with and make some hard choices about whether we're going to recognize international law and international borders or whether the national security of the United States demands that we do something about those Bonnie and Clyde moments. Fourthly, when it comes to the relationship between the groups, Al-Qaeda has a very different view of itself. It says, we consist of a high command or general command, depending on what you're talking about, and our field armies that are out there in something called the regions, the Al-Qalim, and engaging in combat on behalf of the high command and at the behest of and under the orders of the high command. And the death of bin Laden was an interesting test of this claim. Because one would assume, after the death of bin Laden, this charismatic founder, that maybe he was the only thing holding together this disparate group of local affiliates, and that they would simply break up, right? Splinter, fracture, into a bunch of different organizations, but in fact, only one did so. This suggests that in fact, there are stronger ties between these groups than we have been willing to acknowledge. And that means we're not dealing just with a terrorism threat, to do the big reveal here. And we know these not just from statements that are made by Al-Qaeda central leadership, but in fact by affiliates as well. They too have claimed, we are nothing but their soldiers. We are nothing but obeying their orders. Captured documents from Mali, from Abbottabad, and by the way, an interview, a very interesting interview by a guy named Abu Suleiman al-Muhajir, or al-Australi, talks about the relationship for about 45 minutes between the Al-Qalim and the high command. And he was a, or is, I'm not sure what his status is right now, a Sharia official with Ansar al-Sharia, not with Al-Qaeda's central leadership. And that was his claim about the relationship between them. Fifthly,
you're fine.
I'm okay. Captured Mali documents and Abbottabad documents all argue that, in fact, they understand our problem with names, and they're working on messing with us. So there's this great document from Mali. It talks about the fact that Ansar al-Din was told by their commander, the head of AQIM, don't say anything about having any ties with Al-Qaeda or having any kind of global sort of thing. Tell everybody you're a local group and that you have no connection or ties with us. Well, that's not the only place that we see that. A lot of captured documents have that same kind of language, that you don't tell people that Shabab is a member of Al-Qaeda until, you know, years apparently after it had happened, that you don't tell people that there's these ties and connections, because they understand we have this fixation with understanding the relationship with them as being tenuous as possible so we can minimize the problem. See, that's the important thing, right? To minimize the problem. So it's not this huge problem out there. It's something we can deal with, that we can come to, you know, have some solution for. And I think this is actually one of those places where they get at a truly American characteristic. We want to see solutions. We want to see resolution. We want to see victory, an end to this. And we therefore have been sort of defining the problem the way we want to in order to have a victory. Okay. Strategies, the sixth issue I pointed out, do they have one? Well, I've already been talking about it as if they do, but Saif al-Adl, Abu Bakr Neji al-Madani, and a dozen other of their strategic thinkers suggest that they do. They've in fact put out a whole set of strategic documents publicly that we can read, and they've been doing it. It's not just that they're, you know, kind of speculating here or speculating there. They've actually been following through. So of course they have a strategy. It's a strategy that I believe from a captured document in the 1990s is called Al-Minhaj Al-Haraki Li Sirat Nabawi. Came out in two different versions that I know about, one in the 1990s and one in 2006 that you can buy online. That takes the life of Muhammad and lays it across, actually this is, this document doesn't do this, but this is how they do it, lays it across Mao, because they really love Mao. You didn't mention Mao, but in fact Mao underlies their entire military political strategy with a sort of underlay of the life of Muhammad, the Sirat al-Nabawi. So this suggests that we can predict what they're going to do because they've been pretty assiduous in following the Maoist vision. And we actually understand, you know, the Maoist concept of guerrilla warfare fairly well. Now they have a lot of shifts and changes they've made in order to, in my opinion, make the claim that this is more religiously acceptable and some other things like that. But it's not true that we have to be reactive. I think, in fact, we can be proactive if we take the time to read their own strategic documents and lay it across what they've actually been doing in the real world. And finally, that methodology suggests, above all else, that we're not dealing with a terrorism problem, not just because that's what you see in the real world, but because that's not what they want. In fact, the methodology is predicated upon a four-stage strategy. Most people are probably expecting three, right, from Mao. But in fact, Mao did not have a three-stage strategy. Mao had a seven-stage strategy. And their first stage that they talk about, which is called covert jihad, that's why I began with this, begins with the idea that you have to create the group. You have to train people. You have to have safe havens. You have to have weapons. You have to, you know, do all kinds of things covertly so that people don't even know you're around. And only after you've assassinated some people, you've carried out some terrorist attacks, and they begin to understand, hey, these guys are not just carrying out preaching and dawah and other things, they're actually carrying out, you know, attacks against the government. Only then do you come out overtly. And if you lay this across, oh, by the way, come out overtly in the first stage, then is guerrilla warfare in order to carve out these ungoverned spaces and prepare them for the building of institutions and governance. And the third stage is devoted to governance, and in fact is the majority of the book written by Abu Bakr Neji is about that stage, although he talks about the second stage as well. Hazem al-Madani talks about the very first stage, by the way. And he says there are, of course, other stages that I'm going to have to consult with some people about before we come to any decisions about how they should be done. And strangely enough, a year or two later, Abu Bakr Neji's book came out that laid out those second and third stages and what they should look like. The fourth stage, then, is the strategic offensive, in which you'll carry out a massive offensive to take the cities that you've kind of been surrounding, and with your people taking the countryside and so on and so forth, sort of like what happened in Syria and Iraq in 2014. Because ISIS has the same commitment to this concept. They simply believe they're at a different piece or place in these stages. They've already believed they've advanced beyond the so-called equilibrium or no war, no peace stage when you're building institutions. All right, so is this then a terrorism problem? Well, we have the answer from Al-Qaeda and ISIS themselves. No. It's an insurgency problem. And they don't just want their own little nice, you know, country someplace that they can call the caliphate and they can feel important and run the way that they want to. They want the entire world. And they've said that since the very beginning. So is this now an existential threat to the United States? No, absolutely not. But if we leave it alone, if we let it go, it will become an existential threat. Because let's remind ourselves, the Bolsheviks started off as five people. You know, at one point, they all could have been rounded up and that would have been the end of it. Nazism started off apparently as one lone nut. If you leave it alone, though, if you don't pay attention to it, if you don't do something about it, like cancer, it will become a threat and a problem that will be nearly impossible to deal with in the end. Thank you.
Good. Thank you. Please show your appreciation. Good. I hope we can develop that in Q&A. I mean, I think it's enormously refreshing to take the perspective of how others see us rather than viewing the entire world. In the UK, this is the Wickhamist fallacy, named after the School of Winchester, where its pupils fall into the mistake of viewing the world through the Wickhamist perspective, whereas in fact you want to view us from the eyes of others. So thank you very much. Audrey.
I'm actually going to speak at the dais, if that's okay. Yeah. I'm vertically challenged, so I think Absolutely. We'll all be better off. It's really a pleasure to be here. Which mic am I using, this one or mine? Mine. Okay, excellent. Away with you. I'm very fond of Georgetown. I was actually here on September 11th. So every time I come back, I remember that day. I was at the top floor of the Intercultural Center right next door and saw the smoke rising up from the Pentagon and had to give a talk to all of the students, 900 students in an enormous, I think it's the big auditorium over there. But anyway, most people were fleeing from town and of course the students couldn't go. So. My job was stay here and be with them and reassure them, and it really made an impact upon me. So I will always have a very warm place in my heart for Georgetown, as well as some memories of some difficult days for all of us. I'm going to agree in some part with what Mary just said, in that I'm going to argue that we are misframing ISIL in particular. But I think I'm going to disagree a little bit, because I'm going to argue that it's not a counter an insurgency. It's actually a pseudo state. And I don't say that in order to give it legitimacy. I think it's completely illegitimate. But I think we're using insufficient tools to face the nature of the state of the threat as it is. And I'd also like to just say at the outset that I will be talking strictly about the Islamic State, ISIL, ISIS. I think there are very significant differences between ISIS and Al-Qaeda. I've laid those out in earlier writings. I wrote a foreign affairs piece where a couple years ago where I talked about this. So I'm strictly talking about the threat as it is encompassed in ISIS now, even though it does have some ties, of course, to Al-Qaeda, including historical ties. So ISIL is more than a terrorist group, and yet that is how it's often described and thought of. This will become a problem for the new administration. My talk is designed to think about especially American policy at this time of transition between with the new administration taking hold. ISIL is a pseudo-state that holds territory in both Iraq and Syria. It has an army of tens of thousands. It maintains extensive military capabilities. It controls lines of communication, commands infrastructure, funds itself, has an established leadership structure, court system, police force, and it engages in sophisticated military operations. Yet we continue to insist that it's a terrorist group and that counterterrorism is a sufficient answer. Understanding the nature of the enemy is an ancient imperative of statecraft. We can all go back and reread Sun Tzu. Yet the U.S. has a legacy of mischaracterizing this enemy that began in 2003. When we dismantled the Sunni-dominated Iraqi military, laid the groundwork for them to become insurgents, we still called it counterterrorism. 5 months after the U.S. invasion of Iraq, the insurgency in Iraq was obvious. Yet Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld denied it, calling the insurgents a bunch of no-hopers carrying out terrorist attacks. ISIL emerged because of three important developments. The first was mistakes made by the U.S. government in Iraq, all under the rubric of counterterrorism following 9/11, especially the wholesale dismantlement of the Sunni-dominated Iraqi army. The second was mistakes made by the Iraqi Maliki government after the U.S. withdrew. Marginalizing the Sunnis, violently crushing Sunni protests, and giving the Sunnis nowhere else to go but ISIL. And then finally were the opportunities that were provided by Assad's crushing of the 2011 uprising and the resulting chaos of the civil war in Syria, giving ISIL the perfect sanctuary in which to rebuild. Now ISIL is essentially a state sponsor of terrorism with the kind of sophisticated programs, capabilities, and reach of some states. We're going back to the 1980s, in a sense, to the days when state sponsors of terrorism threatened Americans and Europeans with major terrorist attacks, but with today's technological resources. It's not a coincidence that ISIL and its affiliates occupy parts of the territories of long-standing former state sponsors of terrorism, notably Libya, Iraq, and Syria. So my presentation will address three questions. The first, why can't we name the enemy? Second, what difference does it make to our policy? And then finally, how can we refresh and reframe to be more effective in the future? So let's start with why can't we name the enemy? I think we're still suffering from our 2003 legacy of self-delusion. There are three major reasons why we've stuck to this self-deception. First is the vast bureaucracy set up in the wake of 9/11, whose mandate and funding was specifically focused on counterterrorism. It encourages us to describe everything in those terms. Second are the legal authorities that Mary also referred to, under which the United States is still operating strongly and favoring defining any threat as terrorism. Just to remind you, the AUMF reads, quote, that the president is authorized to use all necessary and appropriate force against those nations, organizations, or persons he determines planned, authorized, committed, or aided the terrorist attacks that occurred on September 11th, 2001, or harbored such organizations or persons in order to prevent any future acts of international terrorism against the United States by such nations, organizations, or persons. It's legal authorities that are helping us frame how we talk about this threat publicly by our officials. It's not just a matter of willful denial. There are legal implications to what we call this group. Finally, terrorism resonates politically. What domestic U.S. constituents care most about is terrorist attacks by violent Islamists against Americans, especially on U.S. soil. Yet, I would argue that ISIL is not a terrorist group. Beginning in 2009, it transitioned from terrorism into insurgency, into civil war, and finally into a conventional military force. Its declaration of a state, which was illegitimate to be sure, was backed up by the infrastructure, hierarchy, and trappings of a state. Wouldn't it be nice if ISIL were merely a terrorist group? Our goal should be to push it back in that direction. But it's not that now, I think. It's a pseudo-state that sponsors terrorism. State sponsors of terrorism have tanks, artillery, armored Humvees, missiles, research and development programs that are long-standing, very sophisticated online recruitment programs that are carefully targeted. They have media operations that exploit successes and project an image and an ideology. They have two-way communication with potential operatives, assets that are developed by sophisticated experts. They can recruit people, develop sleeper cells, and project terrorist attacks abroad. All of those things are exactly what ISIL is doing. This organization is shape-shifting, and it's not historically unprecedented in doing that. Territorially based movements often transition into insurgency or conventional war as they gain ground. Those kinds of uses of force are much more legitimate than terrorism. They're much stronger forms of military power. And this is what factions and insurgents from the FARC to the LTTE to the Khmer Rouge to the Communist Party of Nepal Maoists have all done. But destroying a state with an infrastructure is different from confronting a terrorist organization. And we have to be much more agile in how we think about this threat and how we respond. We have to make trade-offs. We have to make decisions if we're going to be strategic. So secondly, what difference does it make to our policy? Well, correctly identifying the enemy is the only way to get ahead of the problem rather than simply reacting to it. That's very clear. ISIL is not simply a terrorist group, and calling it that misleads the American people. It hobbles our efforts, and it undermines our ability to fight it. Now again, I'm not arguing that we should broadly be giving it legitimacy by calling it a state. We should call it a pseudo-state or a rogue state or something that is pejorative as well. I'm not trying to argue that we should be giving it legitimacy. But the American people have a misunderstanding of what exactly the nature of this threat is. Two key points pertain to this point. First, we cannot just transfer all the tools that were developed for U.S. counterterrorism against Al-Qaeda. Most of them were first laid out in a memo that Richard Clark wrote in December of 2000, the memo that he wrote to Condoleezza Rice, by the way. We can't take those same tools and transfer them wholesale over to the response to ISIL. Despite its origins in Al-Qaeda in Iraq, ISIL is fundamentally different from Al-Qaeda. Counterterrorism as a framework cannot be infinitely reshaped, morphed, to deal with insurgencies, civil wars, or conventional threats. It's designed to help relatively small groups that generally have only dozens or hundreds of members, attack civilians, do not hold territory, and cannot directly confront military forces. Counterterrorism's tools are necessary but insufficient when dealing with a pseudo-state. Good counterterrorism always has a range of key elements, including intelligence, homeland defense, working closely with allies, police cooperation, sharing of information, working with vulnerable communities, and cutting off terrorist funding. These are all crucial to protecting the homeland from imminent threats. But when dealing with a pseudo-state that threatens regional and global stability, we also need broader, longer-term thinking. For example, there's a fundamental difference between a safe haven and a state. No one would suggest meeting the threat of North Korea, or even Hezbollah, by relying strictly on counterterrorism tactics, such as decapitation or special operations, and neither should we do so with ISIL. Secondly, we cannot infinitely stretch our legal tools and remain true to our values. This is especially true of the 2001 authorization for the use of military force against Al-Qaeda, whose endless reinterpretation to every ISIL-related circumstance is deeply unwise and astrategic. It is well past time to reassess and make a decision about whether ISIL is or is not a top priority. And if it is, to put in place the appropriate funding and legal measures to deal with it. It's the only way for a democracy to fight effectively. We need to make up our minds. If ISIL is a top priority, we must once and for all have a new authorization for the use of force on ISIL to enable a more effective response. Perhaps with a GOP majority in Congress, this can be done. The use of this terrorism framework has enabled Congress to duck its responsibility to deal with this threat. I think that's a very important theme that is not often mentioned in our focus upon executive power, that the US Congress plays an enormous role in legitimizing any sort of a fight like this, and they have mainly been AWOL. On the other hand, if ISIL is not a top priority, we are, after all, a great power, and we need to think about many other things that are going on in the world. If it is not a top priority, important enough to declare war against and allocate regular funding towards, then we must stop deceiving the American taxpayers by using emergency funding that hides from them the true costs of our actions. Americans must be educated about the full range of serious challenges that face a great power and where this one fits. So finally, the third question. How can we refresh and reframe to be more effective in the future? This is not an easy argument for me to make. I've spent many years writing about and talking about non-state actors. And I never thought I'd say this. We are focusing too much on violent non-state actors without understanding and analyzing the actions and policies of states in the region. Because that context within which things are happening is critical, and it is affecting whether our specific policies succeed or fail. We're trying to use surgical measures when the broader body is suffering from a different and much bigger malady. Partly as a result, our position in the Middle East and our policy in the Middle East is in a muddle. By insisting that this is a terrorism problem, we're looking at the ISIL situation through a straw. We obsess about whether they will launch terrorist attacks against us in the short term, while downplaying the pivotal role of states like Russia and Iran, who are brilliantly outmaneuvering us. Our focus is too restrictive. To protect American interests, we must reframe our approach and make some choices. We're supposed to be making strategy. Strategy means not doing things as well as doing things. It means making hard choices. To begin with, we have a range of questions to address. The first relates to Syria. The Syrian refugee situation is the most fundamental crisis of displaced people since the Second World War. It continues to undermine the stability of Europe, a region made up of our most important allies, the bedrock of our policy since 1945. And recent US statements suggesting that NATO is, quote, obsolete, have only made the situation worse. More than 400,000 people have died in Syria. Some 94 have died in terrorist attacks on the United States. Each American death is a tragedy. But where is our sense of proportion? How can we lead if the approach appears to be, quote, the world is open for business and we're in this for ourselves? As Prime Minister May said yesterday, I quote her, we can either be passive bystanders or we can take the opportunity once more to lead. Some countries, such as Russia and Saudi Arabia, appear to be willing to allow the existence of the Islamic State because getting rid of it is not their top priority and may even, from their point of view, successfully confine the problem of Sunni violent extremism to someplace else. Where is the evidence that Russia will help seriously fight ISIL? What are our priorities in the areas that ISIL leaves? Are we committed to stability in the Middle East? What happens in the aftermath of our military operations, for example, in Mosul? And while we're at it, what would the plan be in the event of regime change in Syria? Haven't we learned from the experiences of Iraq and Libya that regime change creates the kind of power vacuum that transnational jihadist groups exploit? So, to conclude, everyone agrees that ISIL is evil. No state supports it, and we have a coalition of counter-ISIL allies, very valuable coalition. The American electorate loves Manichaean struggles. This one's pretty black and white. I guess that's the good news. But it's easier to terminate terrorist organizations than states or pseudo-states. As we destroy parts of ISIL, we're leaving a vacuum of power in the region. Counterterrorism as a framework is not enough to think through that problem. If we think of it as a pseudo-state, we're forced to confront the weaknesses of the broader strategy. What is our vision for a better and more viable future in the region and in the world without the Islamic State? Thank you.
Thank you, Audrey. Brilliant. That's brilliant, Audrey. Thank you very, very much. Fernando.
Thank you very much, Herman. I will also be using the pulpit because of the very, very strong light I have on my face. There's no other reason for that. And allow me to start by saying that I'm also a fan of your staff, in particular of the Center for European and also for Security Studies, and I'm a fan of his director, Bruce Hoffman. I'm also a fan of today's chairman. Following all these brilliant, very, very interesting presentations, you might be already waiting for the Q&A period. So I will be brief, and I will stick on to the main title of the conference. What the new administration needs to know about terrorism and counterterrorism, with a focus on the European Union. We might discuss many issues with respect to this particular topic, but I will be centering my presentation on three of them: the terrorist threat and radicalization inside the European Union, the threat awareness among Europeans, and finally something that I believe the new US administration should know, the most transcendental, the most important recent development in European Union counterterrorism. With respect to my first topic, well, first of all, I will advise the new administration to learn and start making a distinction between Islam as a religion and Islamism as a political ideology, and then Salafism, and even more to distinguish between traditional or political non-violent Salafism and jihadist Salafism. Because I heard in the past, I'm still listening to the in the media statements from even already White House officials, which I don't think they have clear these kind of the distinctions. Having said so, part of what I already had to say was elaborated yesterday by Sir David in his Seven Liars, explaining how the threat in Western Europe nowadays coming from Islamic State, but also from Al-Qaeda and related groups, has a wide range from centralized, highly centralized, well-coordinated attacks, such as those which took place in Paris, November 2015, to, on the other hand, the attacks perpetrated by individuals acting as lone actors, that is, having no organizational connection whatsoever with Islamic State or Al-Qaeda. Interestingly, this category, inside this category of individuals, we have a more than significant number of terrorists suffering from mental illnesses, which was already mentioned, which is not a feature of the of those behind the other categories of the threat. So I will add to what Sir David mentioned yesterday with a reflection on radicalization. And the new US administration should know that not European Union member states are equally affected by the current jihadist mobilization as from 2012. This is not affecting all Europeans the same way. On the one hand, countries where the Muslim population is centuries old are virtually not seriously affected, not significantly affected, including the European Union member states. If you, I always ask this question to my students, and I never get a right answer, including the country which is the European Union member state having the largest percentage of Muslim population as a total, as part of the total population, which is Bulgaria. So not France, not the UK, no, it's Bulgaria. About 15% of the total, but centuries of population. Very, very few cases of radicalization with respect to the total population and with respect to the subtotal Muslim population. On the other hand, the level of the levels of jihadist radicalization over the past years in countries such as Italy or Spain is low when you compare that with the situation in countries such as France, the UK, the Netherlands, Sweden, Germany, and with respect to the total population and with respect to the corresponding Muslim populations. In other words, this jihadist mobilization is affecting, above all, the European Union member states, where the largest portion of Muslims are second and even third generations. It's not affecting seriously countries where Muslims are centuries old people. Is not affecting equally countries where Muslims are largely first generation migrants coming from North Africa or the Middle East. So here we have, maybe you want me to go deep into this, but here obviously we have a problem with inside these diasporas, in particular with respect to second generation, those who are predominant among individuals arrested over the past 5 years, individuals who turned into foreign terrorist fighters, and so on and so forth. We have this identity issue combined with other things. Right, so this was my first point on what the new administration should know about this, that the phenomenon is not requires a differential analysis. And by the way, the levels of jihadist mobilization in the US are comparable to those of Italy and Spain, and not to those of the UK, Germany, France, the Netherlands, or Sweden. Because still today, the vast majority of Muslims in this country are either first generation or converts, still today. So this is something we have structurally in common. And now, about my second point, it is all too often heard that Europeans are not as concerned as US citizens with respect to this problem. Well, the last Eurobarometer, 27 countries wide survey made by the European Parliament just a few months ago contradicts this very, very clearly. We at the Elcano Royal Institute, we know this with respect to Spain's public opinion, but you know, all policy sectors taken into consideration, as from 2015, Europeans place the fight against terrorism as the European Union's number one priority. 8 out of 10 Europeans think that the European Union has to do much more to tackle the threat of terrorism. 7 out of every 10 consider that the existing measures are insufficient. And what are the measures that Europeans think are more urgent in fighting jihadist terrorism, which is basically what I'm talking about now? Although there are still places in Europe where it's not, the issue is not jihadist terrorism. Just spend some time in Corsica. The three most urgent measures have to do with, according to the European public opinion, have to do with the financing of terrorism, countering radicalization, and border controls. Very clearly so. Very clearly so. Just a comment on the issue of countering radicalization. Unless the new administration is able to make this clear distinction between Islam, Islamism, Salafism, Jihadism, and so on, this would make no sense. But in case the distinction is well established, as it is well established in a number, but not all, European Union member states, where you often find officials unable to make it, I find that the new administration should very carefully look at some of the wrongdoings and some of the unsuccessful approaches to radicalization, to the countering radicalization, including the idea that in order to eradicate Salafi jihadists, we have to partner with non-violent Salafists. Because the result is we have similar or even higher levels of radicalization after doing so. But on the contrary, we have been empowering these communities, these non-violent Salafic communities, and expanding the subculture, the anti-democratic subculture, which is characteristic of these communities. Just to give you a very simple example, I was recently in Amsterdam at the end of the year, before the end of the year. The Moroccan Center for Strategic Studies and Elcano joined efforts in trying to assess what's wrong with Moroccan descendants, with second generations, descendants of immigrant Moroccan families, individuals who are Dutch citizens. We had this meeting with a number of them, and there was this man, 24 years old. Of course, you know, he was a Dutch citizen, so all his high education was suffragated by the state, and he had a very nice, stable job as a technical one, as an engineer. And his parents were already middle class, the owners of a series of shops. And at some point he say, regardless of my position, of my socioeconomic position, I will never be socially integrated in this country. And there was this Dutch official next to me who asked him, why? Because we live under democracy, and this is haram, right? This is sinful. He was a Salafi, a nonviolent Salafi. And Salafist communities, they operate under this plan to segregate Muslim communities within the countries in the West where they are living in. And so it's not just about governmental policies or civil society discrimination. Dynamics within Muslim communities, as we found it already in Europe, produce Muslim segregation, spatial and socio-structural Muslim segregation. So this is something I believe the new administration should also be taking care of. Interestingly, Europeans think that only one quarter of the Europeans, by that I mean obviously the respondents to the survey in the 27 countries, only one quarter of the Europeans think that the European Union level is the most appropriate to effectively counter this global jihadist terrorism. 4 out of every 10 think that the global level should be more effective, and only 1 out of every 5 thinks that still the national level is the most effective one. And precisely, this brings me to my third point. I mean, despite Brexit, despite the new president's nationalistic kind of dislike for supranational organizations such as the European Union, the fact is that the European Union has built the most advanced regional counterterrorism regime anywhere in the world. True, only after 9/11. Previously to that, little timid advances to the dismay of countries such as Spain, for instance, because 3,000 people killed on New York on one single day prompted the European Union to initiate, the famous framework decision in 2002 and so on and move on to what we have today. But by that moment, we already have several thousands fatalities perpetrated by terrorist organizations in Europe. IRA, neo-Nazi groups in Italy, the Rote Armee faction in Germany, and so on. So it is true that Europe is moving in this sector following major attacks. 9/11, 3/11 in Madrid, 7/7 in London, and now the Paris 2015 attacks. And precisely following those attacks in Paris, the European Union Council, the European Union Commission, and the European Union Parliament finally decided to move ahead on a number of issues. Among them, for instance, new powers to Europol, the famous passengers list, and so on. But I would like to touch on one particular development, which, in my opinion, is the most transcendental development in European Union counterterrorism since 9/11. You know, it is a fact. That the European Union has many different information systems which are not interconnected. Every country has a different police and intelligence model, a different counterterrorism model. Every country has different information systems, and then we are 27 countries. So until now, countries were reluctant to share this on a collective basis. And I like it, your emphasis on collective, the gap. When Sir David made this point about the gap between the threat and our collective responses. And it is also a fact that information has not been routinely uploaded by member states into already existing relevant databases, SIS, for instance. To understand how important all this is, I will skip that comment on those who perpetrated the attacks in Paris because of the lack, will not be very polite to the Belgian and French authorities. Allow me just to say, remember the individual who perpetrated the attack on Berlin last Christmas? All right, he has been using 14 different identities, travel documents and national identities in different European Union member states. He was able to go in and out and move across the European Union, using 14 different, at least 14 known different identities. So this gives you an idea of how important it is to have all those interconnected databases. But now finally the European Union, as from June 2016, has adopted a number of decisions to overcome the technical and the legal issues with respect to this. But going even beyond that, not just making interconnected those information systems, but also interoperational. So the purpose is to have a searchable simultaneous databases which will overcome the current fragmentation, a unique one for all European Union member states. And for that purpose, something unthinkable just a few years ago, not to mention a decade ago, the European institutions are already discussing the terms of the mandatory information sharing among European Union member states, including not just SIS, but other databases. Never ever before that was brought to the table, making this mandatory for your member states. So, if I am still on time, my final comment is that given all these new developments in the European Union, the new administration should reflect on whether or not it is timely to underestimate the European Union counterterrorism regime, and alternatively opt for bilateral cooperation or the sum of bilateral cooperations in dealing with the threat of terrorism with European partners. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Excellent. Thank you very much, Fernando. Good, well done. Good. Well, four truly outstanding presentations from different perspectives. And it's your turn, ladies and gentlemen, for your questions, comments, and discussion. First of all, just that. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you to the panel for being here this morning. So if we were to redefine this struggle as a counterinsurgency or redefine ISIS as a rogue state, I'm curious, how do you guys envision the after ISIS is defeated without getting involved with nation building or capacity building to the degree that the American people certainly seem to be a little bit fed up with, maybe?
Good, that's great. I think, Audrey, that comes to you, but I'll come to Mary next. Perhaps we can add, and clearly you were constrained on time, but your thoughts about what that strategy might look like if one is confronting a state. That would be
In five words or less. I think it gets to the question of, once again, actually defining where we put that priority in our priorities. So if ISIS is something that we are planning to destroy, and I forget the exact phrase, but it was something along the lines of eradicate from the face of the earth still stays there. And that's only part A of a part A through G process. And it's something for the administration to sell to the American people that there has to be an answer after the eradication. And I don't think anyone is even thinking in those terms. And if it's not that priority, where we are going to increase the use of, apparently, I'm guessing, because we're in the beginning of a brand new administration, increase the use of kinetic operations and increase our footprint on the ground there, if it's not that priority, then we need to stop making claims that that we can't keep over the long term. So as far as what our strategy should be, I think we should face much more coldly and realistically the issue of regime change and stop fighting between our liberal values and our desire for a stable world and decide which one predominates in the Middle East right now. And I think I'll just leave it at that.
Mary?
Yeah, I agree that the problem is there's a set of very hard choices that have to be made. And so far we've had a lot of people punting that down the road and hoping they don't have to deal with it. And it's just got to stop. We can't, you know, keep pretending that all these symptoms aren't cancer and you don't have to go see the doctor. You have cancer. You have to do something about it. And while you don't like chemo, nobody does, while you don't want to have to, you know, take the medicine or go under the knife, guess what? There's nothing else that can be done at this point. So I agree that it's the tough choices that have to be made by this administration. But one of the biggest things that has to be decided, and this was raised yesterday, and it's actually my final class that I'm teaching right now at for SSP. So I'm hoping none of my students are here or that they're going to watch this on YouTube. So I have them discuss what it means to win. And we talk about it from two perspectives. We actually ask, what does Al-Qaeda and ISIS believe winning looks like? And what do we believe winning looks like? And we have a thorough discussion about the concept of victory, what victory means for a lot of people, and so on and so forth. But for myself, I came to the conclusion about 10 years ago that probably winning looks like making Al-Qaeda and ISIS into what they were in 1989, a small terrorist group that's incapable of doing anything beyond local attacks. I think if we got them back to that, I think we'd all be thrilled with it. But in order to do that, we have to understand that on the spectrum between terrorism and insurgency, we're way the heck down on the end of insurgency, where they're becoming regular forces. They're no longer even confined to just irregular warfare. They're now edging into regular warfare. And that means that we must adopt both a counterinsurgency, and this is not to say you don't do counterterrorism as well. Obviously, you have to keep yourself safe. It's not an either or, right? But you have to put the emphasis today on counterinsurgency and, in the case of the pseudo-state, regular warfare in order to deal with it. If you actually want to deal, to defeat it, that's what it's going to take.
I think you're also touching on the difficulty that might inexorably lead you into nation state building. Would that, you're...
Yes, that's correct. So doing those efforts to defeat ISIS or deal with the problem now, and then what does that look like, in your opinion, for the after? Is there a balance or a way to message that to the American people that the administration could use to make it clear that what we're not getting involved in here is nation building? Or is that even possible?
Did you want to deal with that first?
I think that we have to admit that our counterterrorism policy thus far has been very effective in terms of maintaining a relatively small number of attacks in the United States. But in terms of its effect on the global environment, it has been, I would say, much less than effective. And so in order to face that dichotomy, we have to begin to revise what it is exactly that we're doing. And also to face the fact that United States policy has played a role in where we are internationally in the world. We always have this idea that we can talk about the groups as if they have this evolution quite separate apart from anything that we do. And I think that that's one of the ways that we've ended up where we are in the Middle East. So as far as nation building is concerned, I'm not sure it's worthwhile. I'm not arguing that it's worthwhile. I'm not advocating for that. What I'm advocating for is the realization that if you make these kinds of trade-offs, if you decide that that is your top priority, you have to also buy the aftermath, because that's your responsibility too. I'm not sure that's where our resources should go, but it has to be decided.
I don't mean to dominate the entire question and answer period, but maybe other people are interested in this as well. So the problem of popular support, or getting the people to support the president's policies, I think has to do with how the problem is, first of all, framed for them, and then secondly, the methods that are used and whether they show success or failure. So Peter Fever has done a lot of very good work on the issue of popular support, of public support for wars, showing that it's not about casualties per se, but it's about the perception of whether you're winning or losing. So if the perception is that you're incompetent and don't know what you're doing, the American people don't support you. If the perception is that you're actually making a difference, and there you're heading towards some well-defined goal, that you know what you're doing, that you're effective, efficient, however you want to put it, support for very bloody warfare is actually supported by the American people. And while I hate to put it in those terms, you know, I've got relatives in the military myself. I've been over to Iraq twice. I understand the cost that it has, and especially the cost if we commit to something and the next administration pulls the plug. I understand that. But we are the only ones who can do it. So the argument has to be made to the American people on that basis. If we don't do it, it turns out nobody else will. Or we'll empower some very bad actors to achieve their national security ends. And we'll empower other people to achieve their ends rather than ours. And you'll end up with a world that's in far worse shape than if we engage.
Yes, please, Gary.
Just from a perspective, an old Special Forces trooper, first of all, understand what the objective is, and I clearly identify it, and understand what you're getting into. This is the tar baby. You're looking at a region. Let me step back. About 3 years ago, I made a statement, and I said, what's happening in Syria today, in Iraq today, this was 3 years ago, is tantamount for the region like the Spanish Civil War. And now look at us today, who's playing in that sandbox? Now, I think Audrey really nailed it, and she's one of the first people, besides Dave Maxwell, that didn't look at me like I had three heads when I said Islamic State is an occupying power. You've got the territory, and you've got to look at it through that perspective. Not to legitimize it, but geographically, they have an area of occupation. They don't look at themselves as being in Iraq, in Syria. They're looking at their assets, their defensible territory, which they have good internal lines of communication and supply. You're going into an area that is in the midst of a regional Cold War between two powers, Iran, Saudi Arabia, with emerging economic interloper in Qatar. You're into an area that is now manifesting a civil war between two branches of religion, whether anyone likes to talk about it or not, and they've sort of fallen into it. 2 years ago, I would have said, it's a little bit more complicated than that. But the lines are drawing in that regard. So understand, when we talk about nation building, first understand very clearly what you're getting into. I think it's a mistake, personally, because what are you going to build? First of all, Iraq is a shell. Syria is a shell. The cost of rebuilding those countries is going to be enormous. And I'm coming at this from a completely different perspective, because we're dealing with protecting Al-Qaeda and Islamic State target the UN. We get hit every year, and that's part of, I have a specific mindset in my approach, because we're trying to stay one step ahead. We don't operate, we're not an intelligence unit, so we don't have the intelligence capacity that a member state does from the UN. So we're reliant on open media sources. What other states provide us, and what the threat is doing. And we've been able to successfully predict where their movements are, how they were going to react, because out of necessity, we're looking at it through their eyes. And I'm getting a little bit into the weeds there, but I want to approach your question from a different perspective. To defeat Islamic State, I say Islamic State for my own mental discipline. I'm not giving them legitimacy. They are what they are. You call them ISIL. I went through an entire argument, and this is a lesson learned. After they transitioned from At-Tahid wal-Jihad to Mujahideen Shura, where they actually formed the government structure that you see today, this was December 2006, and Al-Qaeda in the Land of the Two Rivers became a subdivision through their Ministry of Defense. I got in trouble because I dare say ISI, and they were saying, Islamic State of Iraq, you're giving them legitimacy. And so now we're debating ISIL, ISIS. I do like ISIS. It does flow better. But for my own mental discipline, I say Islamic State because that keeps my mental focus on how they view themselves. I'm going around a little surreptitiously here. But in defeating Islamic State, what does it mean? Because you're looking at multiple layers. It's a multiple dimensional game board you're dealing with. The physical geographic state that I think Audrey expertly framed from a strategic point of view is one layer. But where are all their also their auxiliary support networks? You know that they started to mint their currency and flags in Kuwait. That's just one example. So branches of their support network are not within that geographic space. So you need to think of, if you want to defeat the Islamic State, which is always a good idea, think in terms of campaigns and what you're going to face next. Because once you, if you can coordinate the international military coalition that's focused in that area, and then defeat them conventionally, then you start to have to plan for the next phase of the campaign. Means and ends, irrelevant in this particular scenario, because you have multiple layers to deal with. And it just depends on what the definition of victory is. That's my two cents.
Okay.
One last quick point.
Yep.
I agree with that. So the question is not if we don't do it, no one else would. With all due respect, Mary, I think it has to be defined. If we don't do it and then remain in endless occupation of Iraq and Syria, that's an end state that I think we need to think about very carefully. I think one analogy is not at all perfect, but one way that I think about it is in 1983 when Hezbollah killed 241 Marines and was targeting Americans actively and many of our allies as well, we didn't go in, and we could easily have done, gotten rid of Hezbollah at that point, using strictly kinetic force, I mean gotten rid of. That's another thing I could question, because I'm not sure that they would have ended permanently. But nonetheless, we are not currently in occupation of Lebanon. And there was a reason why. It was because we were in a broader Cold War context. We had other great power concerns to think about. One of the unquestioned or sort of unthought about assumptions in this conversation is, where do we put our relationship with China? We have limited resources. How do we consider whether or not we have to put some of those resources toward what's happening in very important geopolitical terms in China? How about our relationship with Russia? What exactly are we doing with respect to their interests in Syria? If we had thought about that more clearly 2 years ago, I think we wouldn't be in the situation we are in today. You know, we have other competing concerns. What about the future of NATO? Our alliances. What kind of a great power are we if we're strictly focusing upon one threat and not thinking about how the rest of the world is shifting and how we are helping it to shift? So I'm concerned about limited means applied to objectives, and what exactly is the objective compared to other objectives that the United States should be thinking about?
Mary, and I'll move on after
this. I'm totally sorry, but you're absolutely right. I actually never got to the point where I said what it is, right? Okay. So the point is that I was kind of setting the strategic landscape that we should not begin with an assumption that the American people will not support this. I absolutely do not believe that. I actually think there is an argument that needs to be made. It has to be made well. And it has to be made on the right grounds. But I reject the assumption that the American people will not support it. Secondly, one of those grounds has to be about success and what our actual record of success in fighting these kinds of wars is. During the 20th century, the United States fought a dozen irregular wars and won every single one of them except for Vietnam. That I don't think is widely known. Three of them in the Philippines. And it's not true that they were all before 1945. There were about a half dozen after 1945 that the US fought and won. That's one. Two, the record in Iraq is actually very different than I think common wisdom is. The US actually defeated the insurgency, but we had a secondary problem underneath that, and that is a civil war, a sectarian civil war. And we know how to deal with those as well. We did very well in Bosnia, but we still have troops in Bosnia, and rightly so. It's not 10,000, it's not even 1,000. But you have to, when you have a sectarian civil war, you have to have some form of force on the ground for at least a generation. That's not 20,000, 30, 50, or 100,000, it's maybe 500 people that act as that kind of thin red line that keeps the two sides separated sort of emotionally almost, that reassures them that the other side is not gonna pick up guns again and start slaughtering them. It happens all over the world. If the US had kept even 1,000 troops in Iraq, after 2011, we would not be looking at the same problem that we're dealing with today. But instead, we kicked everybody out and said, hey, deal with it yourself. And of course, there was complete and utter mistrust. If Bush had done the same thing in 2000 and come in 2001 and said, hey, we're enough with this Bosnia, you know, nation state building, which he was very critical of, and had withdrawn all of the US support for what was going on in Bosnia, I guarantee you by 2002, 2003, 2004, you would have had a spin-up of that civil war as well. And everybody would have looked at the 1990s as being an abject failure when it came to nation state building.
Okay. Congratulations on that question. It elicited 10 minutes of very impressive response. Thank you. Please. Lady at the back. Yeah.
I'm struck that you're talking, you to Klaus, I'm struck that you're talking about war and more war and boots on the ground, but have not mentioned any diplomatic efforts that might actually be far more important in at least circumscribing the problem that we're dealing with. Arguably, the Obama administration did take a look at the situation and decided that there were no good allies in the area to work with, and therefore the only option was lots of Americans on the ground, which even if we say that we don't want to get into nation building, once you put large number of American troops into a situation, they do start very quickly to build roads and provide welfare services and all of that. It seems to me that we have been dealing in the area with so-called partners who are constantly double-dealing. We pay large sums of money to Saudi Arabia, which nonetheless had a very active role in the problem. Same can be said for NATO member Turkey. So my question then is, what should be done in terms of diplomatic efforts to at least, let's accept your argument that we need to intervene more strongly to at least to define the mission and curtail it.
Good. I'll start with the ladies.
Well, I did lay that out in an article 2 years ago in Foreign Affairs, and I think that we haven't been talking about it here, but that's it's implicit actually in what I'm arguing. I think not dealing well with the Syrian refugees and the tremendous humanitarian outflow from that region was an extraordinarily important counterterrorism mistake. It was seen as a sort of a bleeding heart, you know, humanitarian, you know, you have these stovepipes of opinion in the United States where you've got your hawks and your doves. This was neither one. This was a strategic error, and it also happened to be a humanitarian mistake. Had we dealt effectively, more effectively, with the outflow of humanity and maintained, you know, effective places for them to be cared for, had we provided many of the resources that we actually turned to kinetic force or to providing other people's kinetic force toward supporting the Syrian refugees, we might actually have an argument now to make that that this is not a battle strictly between quote-unquote Islam and the West. So that's the first thing. Yes, we're way behind in how we use our broader tools, not just putting people on the ground and using kinetic force, even when you're talking about special operations and drones and surgical uses of force. And then secondly, I think the diplomatic efforts have been vital. Not very easily accomplished. We have a very difficult relationship with Russia. This is one of the other things that has been a mistake, I think, that has developed over the last couple of years. And we have no choice but to engage with the other major powers, Russia, Iran, and all of the other major powers within the region, to chart a future for the region that is viable.
Mary, did you want to comment?
Well, it sounds like what I'm arguing is, hey, the U.S. has to just go do it alone, because we see the problem, we have the resources, so we should go. And that's absolutely not what I'm arguing. Without partners, without friends, without allies, we cannot do this. Absolutely, positively. Everybody has mentioned, or not everybody, but several people have mentioned constraints in funding, constraints in our forces. There's obviously a whole set of things that we recognize, by the way, after 9/11 as being problematic with us taking on more than one battle at a time. So one of the things that was falsified after 9/11 was that the military could in fact fight two small wars simultaneously, which was supposed to be their strategic force size. It turns out we took too much of a peace dividend in the 1990s, and we're in fact incapable of doing what the force was supposed to be able to do after 9/11. Now, that has to, obviously, has got to change. The U.S. has to be able to build itself up to the place where it can do that sort of thing again. But in the meantime, absolutely, positively, we have to be working with partners, friends, and allies. But as we've seen over the past 5-6 years, if the U.S. does not lead, either bad actors will take the lead and do what they want, or others will simply not be able to have the capacity to put together that kind of coalition necessary to do not just anything, but the right thing. And the right thing in this situation, as I think I've mentioned, is counterinsurgency, which we have a little teeny bit of experience with since 2006, and which we can use to train allies, friends, partners, whoever we want to, but you have to do it side by side with them. You cannot expect people to go off there and do it on their own without us beside them. It's just not going to happen. They won't do it, either they won't do it right, and we'll have atrocities committed, or they'll just achieve their own national security aims, and who can blame them? If we're not willing to put our boots on the ground and risk our lives, why should anybody else go out there to achieve our national security aims?
Okay, please.
Good morning. Thank you all for your time. I had two questions for the panel based off Dr. Cronin's call for a new authorization for the use of military force. The use of the 9/11 AUMF to use force against ISIS has certainly been challenged, but clearly not enough to restrict the president's use of force against ISIS. Under this interpretation of the 9/11 AUMF, the president still has all necessary and appropriate authorities to use force. If this is the reigning interpretation, is a new AUMF 100% necessary? And two, what language would grant new and better authorities to the president?
Audrey?
The AUMF, of course, because I read it, asserts the authorities to fight against those who are associated with the attacks of September 11th. The interpretation has been that there are enough necessary and appropriate authorities, in part because the executive branch is not going to want to give up any potential maneuverability. I don't agree. I don't think they have the appropriate authorities, because I think they need to have authorities that actually are much more transparent with respect to revealing the costs of what we were doing to the American people in an honest way, costs legally and costs in terms of funding. One of the reasons why we have a misperception at home that we can have zero risk in the United States is that the costs of what we are doing abroad have been shuffled around. You know, we use contingency funding. We use these authorities that have been in place since 9/11. The American people are not actually privy to the reality of what's going on in the world and how it affects them as a result. So I would respectfully disagree. I don't think that they are all of the appropriate, perhaps necessary, but not all of the appropriate authorities that we should be deciding about what our future strategy is and what part of that strategy involves ISIS.
Oh, since I agree 100%, I'm,
good.
Yeah, I'm
okay.
Totally cool with that.
Good. Any further comment? Or? Okay. Further hands. Good.
Hi. I just have a question for Dr. Reinares. I'm very interested in counter-radicalization initiatives, particularly applying or morphing or European models to the U.S. Context. And I'm curious how you think that can be effectively done. One of the arguments that is commonly made against counter-radicalization initiatives in the U.S. is that it does not comport with U.S. strategic culture. And I'm curious how you suggest politicians and people working in the U.S. in counter-radicalization or interested in doing so can build the political will to engage in this initiative, get political or popular support, and get the funding necessary?
Fernando.
Well, I don't think I can answer all the different aspects that you bring with this question, but the new administration should certainly be familiar with the European Union strategy to fight radicalization and recruitment into terrorism. But then, only very few countries have already implemented that international counter-radicalization programs. Chiefly among them, the UK, and the revision is about to appear, perhaps in days or weeks. The Netherlands, Sweden, and the other countries are just starting now to implement programs. Given the fact, or taking into consideration the composition of the Muslim population in the US, and the fact that the second generations will be emerging over the coming decade, perhaps outnumbering first generation and converts, which converts are unusually overrepresented with respect to other European countries, even among those arrested for jihadist terrorism offenses. The numbers are astonishing, four or five times what you will usually find in Western European countries. So my advice would be, you have to assess what has been done in countries such as the UK, the Netherlands, Denmark. You have to take in consideration there are important differences between the social structure location of Muslim communities here in the US and in Europe, and assess what went wrong, what was efficient. It's not that we have very good news, not at all. I mean, the levels, once again, the levels of jihadist radicalization in those countries which over the past decade decided to draft, approve, and implement counter-radicalization programs are now much higher than before they decided to implement those programs. A lot of mistakes have been made, including the one I just made a reference to, siding with non-violent Salafis, empowering them, thinking that that they were those in a better position to delegitimize jihadist Salafists. And to make a proper evaluation, an independent evaluation of the outcomes of those programs, in order to face what is coming, which is the advent of these second generations. As far as we know, except perhaps for some areas in France, the issue with respect to radicalization, if I have to make a very quick comment of interest for the new administration, is that the radicalization is much less related to socioeconomic conditions, in particular poverty, marginalization, and so on, than to cultural ideological factors. The differential association that you will typically find among individuals radicalized and recruited mainly for the Islamic State is, on the one hand, that they have been exposed to a radicalizing agent. And secondly, that the radicalization recruitment process took place amidst a dense web of pre-existing affective ties based on neighborhood, based on kinship, based on friendship. So the process is not uniformly distributed with respect to the distribution, territorial distribution of the population. It's taking place in clusters. And when you go, even physically, I was shortly before I came here, I made a trip to Ceuta and Melilla, once again, the two most problematic cities in Spain, precisely the only two cities where we have second generations predominant within Muslim populations. The exposure of individuals to a radicalizing agent inside a Salafist cultural center, inside a mosque, inside or in other locations, is that face-to-face interaction is still predominant. There's much talking about online radicalism. Okay, I know, but the data we have is that, first of all, the vast majority of individuals radicalized as a result of a mix of online and offline environments. And the number of individuals who radicalized and ended up recruited, whose radicalization process was only offline, clearly outnumbers the number of individuals whose radicalization process and recruitment took place only online. So given that general perspective, I would say that, on the one hand, the new administration has a lot to learn about the outcomes not always successful of the experience that we have. So, chiefly focusing on the UK, the Netherlands, and Denmark, I would say. And then partners such as Italy and Spain might be of particular interest because we are facing the same future uncertainty with respect to these coming second generations, likely particularly vulnerable to the propaganda and the action of radicalizing agents. The face-to-face interaction with radicalizing agents. I can only refer to data coming from Southern Europe, Portugal, Italy, and Spain for this statement. But the concentration of radicalization clusters tends to take place there where you have a higher density of Salafist congregations within the Muslim population as a whole. So countering radicalization is about countering violent radicalization, but it is also about doing something with respect to the radical milieu, which might be non-violent, but it's strongly anti-democratic, anti-Semitic. I mean, it's affecting, it's eroding the social cohesion of our societies. And it is within those communities where endogenous processes of segregation take place, and the jihadists, when they want to send an individual
to act as a radicalization recruitment agent. They know where to go. They don't go to congregations where the Malakites are predominant. They go to the congregations where, given money coming from our partners in the Arabian Peninsula, or Pakistan, or even already within powerful Salafist communities in the West, they are being able to establish all these, in some cases, even no-go areas.
Okay, thank you. Mary, you want to add a footnote?
Yes, just a tremendous presentation. Really appreciate this. Just to add a little bit to it, I tend, as usual, to go back to say, okay, so how do the extremists actually think about this process? And what do they think they're trying to achieve? And they do think about it as a process, first of all. And then they, secondly, think about it in terms of recruitment. They don't use the term radicalization, obviously. That's our term for it. They call it recruitment. And they actually put out a manual of recruitment about 4 years ago, 5 years ago, publicly, for people to use in order to understand how to go about pinpointing these different groups that might be open to your ideas, who is, you know, the kinds of ways that they create friendships in order to win them over. They actually had checklists. How many times have you met with this person? How many times have you spoken with them about these issues? And they give them these worksheets, and you know, you're supposed to fill them out, and how much stuff you're... This is, again, one of those things, if we were paying attention to what they were doing, it would actually make our job a whole lot easier, wouldn't it? If we kind of have these cheat sheets about what they think. But one of the things that struck me about this is they said, we actually do not put forward as the main targets for this the Salafi communities. That was one of the things that really struck me. And I only realized what they actually meant later after reading other things about them, and that is the Saudi Salafi communities are actually rather resistant to them, right? It's the Sahwa Salafi communities, those that have been strongly influenced in particular by Sayyid Qutb, that they pinpoint. So the Qutbist strain, by the way, bin Laden was a member of the Muslim Brotherhood. But he was a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, the Qutbist strain of the Muslim Brotherhood, and he's really the one, he and his fellow compatriots, who put together the Sahwa Salafi side of things with this Qutbist strain, through, of course, Muhammad Qutb, who is one of his mentors. At college. So in any case, so they have, it's even more specific, the kinds of things you can look for in order to be able to pinpoint who these people are, not just the broader Salafi movement. So for instance, on this point of democracy, the Saudi Salafis actually don't take a stance on it, and they don't have a firm kind of like democracy is evil. But the Qutbist strain absolutely positively does. And the Sahwa Salafis, there was a huge outcry when the Sahwa Salafis in Egypt won the election there. And first of all, ran for an election. So in all of the sort of social media that they used, everybody was condemning them for daring to do this. And they had to put forward, you know, justifications for why it was good to have one election one time, right? So. So it's even, you can really pinpoint it down to those sorts of communities.
If I may add to what Mary just said, yes, we have Salafist communities not taking side on the issue of democracy, but that usually is a calculated position of the individuals who lead those communities, because they know that those statements will harm their request for financial support, lands where to build mosques, and so on. I remember years ago when the attack in Barcelona was foiled early 2008, the attack in the metro, that the Catalonian government, which has been playing politics with all these different entities. Wanted to show how the Catalonian Islamic community was attached to the democratic ideals, and requested the public presence of the leadership. They renounced before doing so, but they were receiving a lot of money from the government. From the state government, from the local government, from the regional government, but they preferred to resign than to make any haram a statement in favor of democracy.
Okay. Please.
Very, very, very quickly. When recently in one of these two North African enclaves I mentioned, there was this case of Salafist radicalizing agent who his task was the following. He detected this Salafist cultural center, and then with the help of individuals inside, he was granted access to the files of children and adolescents having problems at home. So he really wanted to know who was already into this Salafi subculture, but was also very vulnerable, in need of affection, in need of... So that's the way they operate.
Yeah, they mentioned that in the manual that I'm talking about. They mentioned looking for those
that's
people who are seeking.
I've got a question here, if I may. Thank you.
Tom Dickinson, Georgetown University Security Studies Program alumnus. Thank you all for a great panel this morning. My question has to do with Al-Qaeda and Islamic State strategy as we know it. Do you think it includes another 9/11 scale attack on the United States or Paris or Berlin or London, or is it death by a thousand cuts where we see Berlin, Nice, Orlando, San Bernardino, that kind of thing?
Mary, you start.
So one of the things that's been very helpful by studying things sort of from above, right, taking a look at what they believe they're achieving, what they hope to achieve in the future, what they say their objectives are, is you can kind of then take that and lay it over their actions and say, okay, where do they think they're at? And then every once in a while we get some confirmation from captured documents or released documents from the Abbottabad trove. So what you see if you do that is that before 9/11, they had a concept, and this is both obviously together because the Islamic State didn't split off until, you know, really 2014, definitively. Both of them together had a concept of individual countries going through these Maoist stages. And then somehow, it really wasn't clear from the documents we have, this was all going to come together. These individual states would, you know, rise up, and then they'd somehow, like T2, you know, the Terminator, kind of run together, and out would come this monster, this, you know, this great thing. But after 9/11, they went through a reform process that you can follow in their published documents, in which they talk about the fact that we're no longer looking at this on an individual basis, but we're treating the entire world like it's one regime. And they're helped by the fact that in Arabic, Nizam means both regime and system. So the international system becomes an international regime, with the United States as sort of the capital. And they talk about the rest of the countries of the world being their provinces. And then they took this concept, this Maoist concept, and laid it over the top of the world. But as above, so below. You're still doing it on an individual basis, but you have this concept that your whole world goes through these stages, right? So what one can say is that during the 1990s now, you have a reinterpretation of the 1990s, that you're in covert jihad. So how many attacks did Al-Qaeda actually claim during the 1990s? Zippo, zero. They didn't claim any of them, including 9/11.
World Trade Center 1993?
None. They didn't claim anything. including 9/11. So that's the covert jihad stage. And then the second stage is overt guerrilla warfare, right? It's called the strategic defensive, which is kind of confusing. But what they mean by that is you're simply taking back what is rightfully yours, and that is all of these other countries. So they began to encourage on a very much a global basis the engagement of the US in all of these wars where they could be drained, they could be exhausted, they could be attrited. And that's the purpose of that first stage. And you're supposed to clear them out of certain areas. And then you enter the third stage, which is called global equilibrium or strategic equilibrium or balance or no war, no peace, in which you no longer carry out attacks on the central government because they've retreated from your lands. And instead, you focus on institution building on a local basis and the creation eventually of a regular army that's going to be used for the final offensive. So from the statements they themselves have made and their discussion of this stage, especially of equilibrium, one might make the argument that in 2011, they believed the US had retreated. That is, the central power had retreated back to its capital, and now you could enter into, on a global basis, equilibrium and focus then on institution building at a local level. So in my opinion, understanding their grand strategy gives you not a perfect, because they also believe you can retreat from stages, just like Mao did, or Jop. Actually, Jop is a big favorite of theirs as well. I mentioned because it's so often taken that he's simply a student of Mao. But they're big fans of Jop because Ilyas Kashmiri, one of their strategists, was in fact wrote his master's thesis on Jop. So they're big fans. But in any case, their vision then in 2011 was, we have entered this. And I went back and took a look at how they described equilibrium in the captured documents we have. And it's all about not engaging the central government, not getting them involved, because you don't want them to interfere in your business now that you're able to create states. So I can speculate, although I don't have any proof for this, that there must have been some sort of decision. We've entered equilibrium. And therefore, you don't want to carry out massive attacks because you would simply draw the ire of the central government. Now, will that hold? I don't know. They might have changed their minds. But it might not be the case, and this is again a might, that it's not really about us being so good, but about them making some strategic decisions about things. And again, this is speculation.
Good. I'll turn to the other members.
I would only add that what we have done and where we are good and where we are not good does make a difference. So you can find a lot of conflicting statements in many of the strategic documents that you get either from Al-Qaeda or from Islamic State. I would say that they place their emphases differently. I don't think it's all kind of coherent in terms of the degree to which they agree about whom to attract, how exactly to carry out what they're trying to achieve over time. Al-Qaeda is pretty clear that they placed a high priority upon mobilizing the Ummah and doing that first as a stage to working toward something greater in the long run. So there was the famous fight between Zawahiri and Zarqawi, Al-Qaeda and Islamic State origins, where Zawahiri was saying, don't target other Muslims. They were worried about the degree to which they could continue to draw the Ummah, as they saw it, to their own cause. They were also very concerned about sectarian attacks. They were not particularly interested in establishing a territorial caliphate right away. Islamic State is quite different. Of course, many of the origins are similar. The strains go back to Qutb and also to the Diobandists. And you can find just about anything you want, honestly, to justify your arguments. But the Islamic State has been far more concerned about polarizing, about attacking other sects, about labeling people infidels, about establishing a territorial caliphate now, about drawing thugs and criminals. They're not. Al-Qaeda was more concerned about having a sense of purity among the jihadists. They were more like knights. There's a reason why it was knights under the Prophet's banner. The Islamic State uses a tremendous amount of violence in order to draw people to an image of power. So I think that the difference of their ways of attracting, their ways of recruiting, their ways of establishing their narrative does matter with respect to how we interpret what they're planning to do next.
Okay. Fernando, and then come to Gary.
Thank you. Just two very quick remarks about the 90s and Al-Qaeda. Well, just to remember that the first jihadist attacks ever in the West took place in Paris in the summer of 1995. It was true that the attack was planned and prepared by GIA members, but it was also true that part of the financing came from Al-Qaeda Central. And in those days, the GIA, actually the man who advised GIA's leader to attack deep into France was Abu Musab al-Suri, who in those days was next to Abu Qatada, the editor of the GIA's propaganda magazine, Al-Ansar. And then we have several plots in Europe, some of them not that well known, but that linked to Abu Zubaydah in Afghanistan. And the second point is, may there be a shift in, by the way, concerning the West, a shift of focus? I mean, Al-Qaeda more focus on the U.S., so perhaps for Al-Qaeda and the Islamic Maghreb, whose main enemy is France. Al-Qaeda more focus on the U.S., and the Islamic State more focus on Western Europe, Rome, Rumilla, actually that's what the propaganda magazine is now rebranded, and with a very strong interest in promoting radicalization and recruitment out of provoking social strain and affecting social cohesion in Western Europe. Actually, after all, in the context of this current jihadist mobilization, looking at the number of foreign terrorist fighters, young Muslims from Western Europe are 20 times overrepresented among foreign terrorist fighters in Syria and Iraq than young Muslims coming from every other region in the world. So that's an important pool of recruitment for Islamic State. And every time there's an attack and we have this attempts to divide between Muslims and non-Muslims and to establish this kind of cleavages, that favors the Islamic State recruitment efforts.
Okay. Gary.
I have just a different view on this, because I don't think we should throw babies out with bathwaters with respect to tactics, techniques, procedures, intents, methods, etc. The question is, will they attempt another mass casualty event like 9/11? If they have the means, opportunity, capability, I should not discount it. And I don't think we should try to put ourselves in a mindset that they won't do that again. There are reasons, there are geographic reasons, there are strategic reasons why they haven't done certain things. They have perpetrated mass casualty events. I'm taking a look through the prism of their intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance processes. I teach a workshop on this through their eyes, and in order to stay current, I got certified by them online. I took manuals from Afghanistan from their training course. They had a two-week training course. And they tested their ability. It's not the blast that they're concerned about. It's the after effect and the preparation for it. And they made it into a science. They took best practices. How did they took best practices from the IDF, from Egyptian Islamic Jihad and Hezbollah. Then they took manuals from our own special forces on reconnaissance. They molded them together. My job was to see what the influence was. So from that, this is a little, I'll just kind of go a little bit forward here. We started to get mass casualty attacks at the UN, and we had a very fortunate, serendipitous trifecta of getting interviews with captured ISR cell leader, thanks to Sir David. We got an interview with this person before he was hung. Attack on UN office in Islamabad, the ISI captured the operational cell leader, and after Algiers, again, thanks to Sir David, the Algerian government released some data from a captured cell member. What I started to find was, in all three instances, they neatly filled in the matrix of their targeting and planning cycle. So what we've done is to prepare our security advisors for UN facilities and operations around the world. We conduct a red cell. We immerse them into the threat through their eyes and then how they target. And we use the interviews and the matrices of their planning and targeting cycle. And this is how we've been able to sort of predict and forecast where they're going to hit us next based on their communications of intent and the timelines it takes for them to actually go from point A to point B. It's all about knowing where they are in the process. I'm saying this, said that to say this. They are updating their ISR manuals online to help not only the homegrown cells, but also the trainer of cells as a reference point. And they haven't changed the doctrine all that much. What they have done is they've learned their lessons, knowing that they are most vulnerable when they are conducting ISR activities. So they've sort of reduced the number of steps, but synthesized others into it. It's actually quite brilliant. But there is an unexpressed intent. That's the best way I can describe it. When you bounce around these networks and forums, etc., there's a rhythm to it. You could get lost in the hundreds of missives and messages, etc. They also, and I want to make this very perfectly clear, they're well-versed in counterintelligence. Well-versed. So sometimes what you see on the forums isn't what you get. You have to understand the flow of the rhythm of their communication. And I think Bruce outlined it, the WND threat is not dead. If they can do it, they'll do it. So I think it's best to just anticipate the possibility than try to say, well, don't think so. I think if they have the means and opportunity, and only their inner circles will decide where they are in their strategy. This is why I say my biggest concern at the grassroots level may not be the massive mass casualty events, but transitioning from what Islamic State is urging them to do to the more systemic targeting of Al-Qaeda. The pillars of threats that Al-Qaeda laid out in Knights of the Prophet's banner is still valid today. And these are, and I think my colleagues well define them, they are institutional. So I would be very cautious to say no, they wouldn't.
Good. Last quick word.
I always tend to take the 30,000 foot view. Somebody doesn't force me to come down to ground. So absolutely, you have to be prudential, because we really don't know where they're at. And they could change their day or change their minds about where they're at in their grand strategy. I was simply making a statement about what I've observed and what we've seen from the captured documents since 2011. On the other hand, if the United States were to engage seriously in the Middle East once again, boots on the ground, from their grand strategy, one could predict that they would, as they have in other countries, move back a stage. And then that stage, the first stage, absolutely you want to carry out as many mass casualty attacks as possible. So if we were to engage, one should assume that we're going to call down upon ourselves a lot of very nasty behavior by these guys.
Okay. With regret, I must close the session today. I'm sure you'll agree. I think that this panel, each and every one, has made a very important contribution to our thinking in a novel way. The perspective of new analysis of the pseudo-state in a much more clear sense, and the IS view of the world as opposed to our view, which is bound to be defective, of IS. So I think collectively those are enormously valuable. Will you join me, ladies and gentlemen, in expressing our appreciation to a splendid panel? Thank you.